Hi, I'm Karima Brown. It's Sunday and it's time for The Fix.
First up, Transnet CEO Portia Derby is in the hot seat. We dig deep into her plans to restore the state-owned entity to play its critical role in the economy and to enable the transport utility to deliver on the Continental Free Trade Agreement. Then we turn to Deputy Finance Minister Dr. David Masondo on just how the government plans to do its delicate egg dance with all the social partners in pursuit of the national interest. And as is custom, we take a look at what's made headlines in the weekend newspapers and why. The Fix starts now.
Welcome to this edition of The Fix, where every Sunday we hold decision makers to account. We tell you why it matters, how it affects you, and why you should care. Now, comprising six business areas, it has to ensure that freight, rail and road transport ecosystems are in sync. Moreover, Transnet's role as the leading state-owned entity on Africa's continent is vital if we are to reap the benefits of intra-Africa trade. In her first major sit-down television interview since her appointment, I'm now joined in the studio by Transnet CEO Portia Derby. Ms. Derby, thank you so much for joining us here on The Fix. You have taken charge of the entity. You've met and done the meet and greet. But before we get to the business of Transnet itself, just quickly tell us how you are dealing with the coronavirus, because we're obviously trading with countries. China is our major trading partner. What mechanisms have you put in place for vessels that are coming from China, staff, just to ensure that we comply with World Health Organization standards?
Good morning, Karima, and thank you for inviting me. We've got that covered, and we've had a big team working with the Department of Health and all of our ports. You must remember that it takes about 20 to 23 days for a vessel to cross from China to South Africa. So it's pretty much safe given the 14-day gestation period, but we are in close watch.
Okay, let's get to the business now of Transnet itself. Now, unlike most South African state-owned companies, Transnet isn't actually a financial basket case. You know, you have a debt of almost 128 billion in your past financial year, but you've also posted a profit of about 6 billion. But you have an inability to transport goods cheaply and quickly, and this has, of course, weighed down the economy. How are you planning to fix it?
It's a complicated, I mean, it's not as easy as it sounds, right? And not just the transportation, but it's easier to throw a number around. So when you break down the total cost of by which we supply logistics services, it's actually much more complicated than just comparing a rail to a truck. Mm-hmm. However, one of the things that we are looking at is increasing the slots that we have available on our systems. That would increase the capacity that we have available.
Now, when you say you're going to increase the slots, you are obviously also talking about scheduling. Mm. You were saying that, you know, globally that is a major issue. Mm. Now, I'm not even going to talk about Transnet. The transport minister is my guest next week, and I'm going to talk to him about Prasa in terms of trains. Mm. But how do you deal with scheduling when you have blockages of, you know, weeks and weeks where people are not able to access their goods in harbors?
So let's start with the ports first. I mean, one of the big, we're in the business of machine and person interface. If you treat your people right, you have a totally different outcome. So one of the things that we've been focusing on, for example, where there's been quite a lot of congestion, is in the Durban port, where we've looked at gang sizes and increasing the number of gangs, which increases efficiency quite substantially. We're increasing again our levels of training and also moving strong managers to go back to terminal management. Then we've spoken a lot in the media about the new equipment, gantries, cranes and the rest like that we're bringing on board so that we would be able to increase our efficiencies. You see, for people often compare ports and don't look actually at your productivity as a port. Mm. It's not only a function of the people you have, the berth you have, but also the cranes that you have. So often you have people saying that we are very inefficient, and yet they've actually not really done a serious comparison.
But let me bring you to a Treasury report which says that the average turnaround time at Durban Harbour is 3 times longer than at other large ports around the world. It's also prohibitively expensive. The cost of exporting something like a 20-foot container from Cape Town reached something like $2,000 5 years ago, more than double the size of the average for high-income economies. How do you justify those kinds of costs given the inefficiencies?
Yeah, so the costs have... So first of all, right, the turnaround times at the port of vessels is actually quite crucial to improving efficiency, and that's the thing that we have to do. And this investment that I was talking about, which is around machine and the person interface, increasing those and improving those efficiencies. If you'll recall, Karima, in the early 2000s, we were reaching actually these efficiency levels. So there's a lot of investment that we've got to move back towards just making sure that we're maintaining on time and we've got efficient cranes and the rest and the like. That would ensure that we are able to operate more efficiently and can turn ships faster around. The one thing that we've actually all been watching, though, is the change in climate, which is affecting not only sea days in Cape Town, by the way, it also starting to affect Durban. So we've got to look at what's the equipment that we bring on board to ensure that we can withstand a lot more of the bad weather that we're having. Mm-hmm. That's first of all. Secondly, if you look at the total cost of moving a 20-foot container, sure, it's gone. In fact, it's much higher than the $2,000 that you're talking about. I was looking at doing business organizations' data. We contribute about 12% of that total cost. Mm. There's documentation, there's customs that you have to come through. Okay, so the other leg that we have to deal with, that port side, is about 12%, 12, 13%. The other side that we have to work really hard at is that unusually we have most of our manufacturing capacity inland, yeah, and that's an extra 17%. For me, I think that ties up with government's long-term strategy for ensuring that the economy moves increasingly towards the coast, because that leg is something that we would then be able to start squashing. The other part is that we're really very far from markets, right? So 60 to 68% of the cost is the shipping cost, yes, that we have to bear by virtue of the fact that we are far. Cannot disagree with you, though, that our efficiencies, wherever we have control, are absolutely essential.
Now, the president mentioned the dry port area in the Eratropolis in Ekurhuleni, mm-hmm, and so did the premier of Gauteng, mm-hmm, David Makhura. Just talk us through that, because, I remember the Eratropolis being the so-called driver of economic development in the Ekurhuleni area since the time of Monli Gungubele. He mm-hmm has come and mm-hmm gone. Mm-hmm. It feels to me like a cut and paste. We keep on saying we're going to do this. How far are you with that dry port development in the Ekurhuleni area? And how are you going to make sure that the troubles that you have at places like Durban doesn't replicate in places like Ekurhuleni?
So one of the investments that were made, and I'm still getting on top of how far we are with that one, is around Tumble Springs, where we do some consolidation of containers. I'm checking and I'm talking to the team to see how far we are progressing with that. However, as you can imagine, for us, and that's where the intermodality and the partnership with the haulers, transport, the truckers and the rest and the like is absolutely essential, yeah, is that what we need to be doing is doing the port to the terminals and providing the most efficient service that we can.
Now, talking about that, one of the agreements that you have already been negotiating is your work with Eskom. Mm-hmm. At the moment, we have coal being mm-hmm transported with trucks. We've seen a number of challenges with regards mm-hmm to that. Take us through what the agreement is that you've signed with Eskom to get coal via rail to Eskom cheaper and more efficiently.
So currently, we are moving about 13 million tons of Eskom's 120 tons on rail. So the idea obviously would be to increase the amount that we move on rail, because that would help. The bulk costs are much lower, yeah, than trucking. Obviously, you'll still need to have that intermodality between conveyor belts and trucks to get to consolidation points. We've basically set up the team now in January, and we will be ensuring that we improve on those interventions going forward. Mm-hmm. We cover Majuba at present, and soon we might be able to extend beyond, I think it's Majuba and three others, and I can't quite remember the immediate ones that we are covering.
Okay, now, 2 weeks ago, I interviewed the shareholder in your case, the Minister for Public Enterprises, Pravin Gordhan. Let's take a listen to what he had to say about the challenge facing Transnet insofar as gaining your competitive advantage, particularly on the continent.
We've regressed in respect of our ports and their performance. Durban, as a port, used to be number one on the African continent. It's now number three. If you look at some of the statistics, crane moves per hour, etc., we are at about half. We perform at 50% of the best ports on the African continent, let alone globally.
Now, how are you going to get your competitive advantage back? How are you going to, interpret what the ministers essentially, put down as marching orders for Transnet?
Well, I think in the end, we've got to have a broader view than that, right? Two other ports are larger than us, than Durban, not the whole system, than Durban, is Port Said and Port Tangiers, which is larger than Durban as a port. So we've got to increase the volumes that we are moving, not only in Durban, but in our whole port system going forward. But also bear in mind, we are a signatory to the African Free Trade Agreement. So we have to actually start having much more of a partnering strategy between ourselves and the continent.
Okay, hold that thought. We're going to come back to speak specifically about how Transnet is going to get that competitive advantage on the African continent up in a moment. Of course, we're going to take a break. Then we come back to speaking with Portia Derby.